Welcome to New Directions for Women, a program of the Morris County, New Jersey chapter of the National Organization for Women. My name is Rebecca Lubetkin, and I and our entire production crew are all members of Morris County Now. We're all volunteers. We took a course together about 18 years ago. We passed the course, and we've been producing this show ever since. We all have jobs during the day, and this is a labor of love. All of our shows are archived in the Sophia Smith Collection at Smith College, and all of them are on YouTube. It used to be in three parts, now it's in one part, half-hour show, and you can access that at www.youtube.com/mcnownj. Our show's title today is also the subtitle of the book written by today's guest, Mary Walton. The full title of the book is A Woman's Crusade, Alice Paul and the Battle for the Ballot. And I wonder if I stopped 100 people on the street and asked them who was Alice Paul, how many would have even heard of her? How many would have learned about her in school? And yet, it was due to the energetic, total commitment of Alice Paul and those she led that the right to vote was secured for half of the population of the United States. It was the largest enfranchisement in our history. For two-thirds of our history, from 1776 to 1920, women were not allowed to vote. That's two-thirds of our history. While voting may seem to be an inalienable right, it came as the result of years of struggle, perseverance in the face of a great deal of opposition. And the story is a fascinating one, the story of that struggle, and we have just the guest here to tell that story. Mary Walton, who is a Harvard graduate, a journalist who was a reporter for 22 years, for the Philadelphia Inquirer. During that time, she wrote more than 100 magazine articles, stories for the Sunday Inquirer magazine, and she has written 4 previous works of nonfiction. A Women's Crusade was published in August 2010, marking the 90th anniversary of the 19th Amendment extending the vote to women. And welcome, Mary.
Oh, thank you, Rebecca. It's a pleasure to be here.
I'm glad you are, because we have a lot to learn. And I want to ask you, since I asked the question earlier, how many people would know Alice Paul? Who was Alice Paul?
Well, the implication was that not very many people would know. And it's really sad. And one reason I wrote the book was to address that and redress that. Alice Paul was the leader of the militant wing of the women's suffrage movement in this country from roughly 1913 to 1920. And as such, she undertook the struggle for a federal amendment that would give women the country over the vote in one fell swoop. But she was more than just a suffragist, and I say just as if that weren't enough. She was also in the tactics she used and deployed a real pioneer in nonviolent resistance. I like to say that she was to suffrage what Gandhi was to Indian independence and what later Martin Luther King was to civil rights.
So you're talking now about her tactics and the tactics that she envisioned and inspired.
Yes.
For the movement.
Mm-hmm.
That's very interesting. Not only have we not heard of her, but we haven't heard of the fact that she really was a pioneer in nonviolent change. Could you tell us a little bit about her formative years? I'm interested in the influences that encouraged her to commit herself mm-hmm. so totally to the suffrage movement.
Well, the most important was her religion. She was a New Jersey Quaker. She was born in Mount Laurel, New Jersey in 1885. And she was raised with good Quaker values, which meant that she believed in absolute equality, regardless of race, regardless of gender, and regardless of religion. So that, of course, meant that she would almost as a birthright believe that women should be treated equally with men. She was also, thanks to her Quaker religion, absolutely unafraid of authority. Because if you're a Quaker, you believe that everybody is equal, therefore nobody has more authority than anybody else. So that the very earliest Quakers refused to remove the hats in the presence of their so-called betters because there was no such thing. They didn't take oaths because Quakers didn't tell the truth only when under oath. They took the told the truth all the time. So these were things that Alice was raised with that she knew very well. Her ancestors went to jail for their religion and for their beliefs. And that was part of her background. That was part of her history.
Interesting. I didn't know that in New Jersey we had people who went to jail for their religion. But
well, I'm to clarify her ancestors back in England. She was eighth generation in this country.
Oh.
But
she spent some time in England after graduating from college.
Swarthmore. Mm-hmm.
From Swarthmore. Mm-hmm. And while there, she became acquainted with the suffragettes.
Yes, that was also very, very important in her formation. She became involved there with the militant wing of the women suffrage movement led by a British woman named Emmeline Pankhurst. And
she was young, too. She was, what, in her early 20s?
Alice.
Yeah.
Yeah, barely. The year was 1910. She had gone over to England to further her studies. Uh-huh. And she was arrested in that year 7 times. She went to jail 3 times. She was, the women at that time were asking to be treated as political prisoners. And what that meant was they had the right to have visitors, to read newspapers, write letters, and they were turned down. So they went on hunger strikes as a form of protest, and the authorities undertook to force feed them so they wouldn't starve, these poor women.
So these are the women in England.
In England.
You have a photo of that.
I do. I have a photograph.
Poster? It's a poster or?
It was a poster. The party was the Women's Social and Political Union, Emmeline's party, and they put out this poster because they didn't regard force feeding as a humanitarian gesture. They called it what it was, torturing women in prison. So you can see there that there are 3 people involved and they're pouring food down a funnel into this.
Forcing it into
down
the throat
of
one of the women. So that they were protesting that they were being treated as common criminals. Then,
exactly.
Rather than as political prisoners.
As men in those times were. The political men who were in the forefront of political protests had those rights, but they were denied to women. And Alice wrote very graphically of what it was like to be force-fed.
But that was, again, in the U.S., is that
no,
right?
No, when she was in England.
Oh, when she was in England.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I don't know, would you want me to read a bit of that?
Well, why don't we get to the U.S. portion of it, and
mm-hmm.
then you can...
Okay.
Because I know that in both cases she was force-fed.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes.
When she came back from England, she was, I guess, inspired to lead a movement here. And as I understand, one of her first acts was to organize the demonstration in 1913. And that demonstration was a big parade when Woodrow Wilson was...
being inaugurated.
It was mm-hmm. the day of his inauguration?
The day before.
The day before his
inauguration. Mm-hmm.
And could you tell us what happened and what the significance was?
Yes, this was really the first social protest parade in Washington. There had been a group of unemployed men in 1894 who'd marched maybe 500 men for jobs. They were arrested on the Capitol lawn. It did not go well for them. Alice organized a parade that drew somewhere between 5,000 and 8,000 women. It was beautiful. They wore capes and caps in various colors. She had floats. It was a real extravaganza, and she pulled it together in about 2 months. The reason it was important was she was sending a message to Wilson on the day before his inauguration that the women expected results. They expected movement on suffrage out of his administration. Well, the parade ended in a melee, in a near riot. Men had been drinking. They thought this whole thing was very funny, this women marching. 250,000 people came out for that parade, and the crowd, mostly male, spilled into the path of the parade, effectively blocked it, and the police turned their backs on the parade. The men were insulting the women. They were spitting at them, tearing at their clothing.
It sounds as though they had they felt that this would have been the worst thing in the world to give women the vote.
The men?
Yeah.
Yeah, well.
I mean, they're really acting up and acting out.
Well, and women just didn't do this sort of thing in public. I mean, come on, get out and parade? That's not what women did. Women stayed at home.
You know, looking back, though, from our 21st century vantage point, it seems almost inconceivable that people, including other women, could oppose voting for women. What were the reasons that they gave?
Well, probably the most prevalent reason on the part of both men and women was that politics was nasty, it was corrupt, it was ugly, it was brutal, it was men's work. Women's work was to stay in the home, raise the children, take care of her family, and that was her bailiwick. And she did not belong out in the world with the men.
She was in the softer, cleaner
yes.
part of life.
Yes.
What were the real reasons?
Well, that was a real reason. But there were powerful forces organized against the women. One was the liquor lobby. This was a time when there was also a movement for prohibition, which kind of went lockstep with suffrage. And the liquor lobby, the makers and sellers of liquor, the distilleries, the breweries, and let's face it, the drinkers, were very afraid of prohibition, and they were convinced that
prohibition meaning that we would not permit
the sale of alcohol
mm-hmm, mm-hmm. or the drinking of alcohol in public
mm-hmm. or in private. And they were convinced that if women had the vote, they would vote in favor of prohibition. So whenever the suffrage measure came up in a state, the liquor lobby poured money and resources into fighting it. So that was one powerful force against suffrage. And you ask, what are the real reasons? The South was adamant against suffrage. Women's place was in the home, the flower of Southern womanhood shouldn't vote. Also, the Southern Democrats didn't want black women voting. Mm. Black men had had the vote since right after the Civil War. They did not want to see the size of the black electorate double.
Wow. Another reason that I had heard, and you can tell me if this mattered, was an assumption that since most women were married, that would simply be giving their husbands a double vote, since women would tend to vote the way their husbands did. So what's the point of it? You might as well just have the men voting.
Right. I think that was tied to that earlier argument that women just didn't belong in politics.
And there was such a sense of urgency, though, and such a sense of this could really be a serious thing, that you know that there were these ulterior reasons.
Well, the opposition took the suffrage movement very, very seriously. And, you know, it had been going on since 1848 in the Declaration of Sentiments, and there was sentiment building, and the progressive era, many reforms. Reform was in the air, although the progressives were not really, aside from really didn't take on suffrage as one of their causes. It's kind of interesting.
What were the, you talked a little bit about the tactics of the opposition. Could you talk about the tactics of the suffrage movement and the organization of the suffrage movement and how they were managed to be successful?
Well, the large suffrage organization of the day was the National American Woman Suffrage Association, an amalgam of organizations that Susan B. Anthony and Elizabeth Cady Stanton had basically organized and been a part of. They claimed 2 million members throughout the country. They had chapters in every state. So Alice comes along and she cooperates with the National. They send her to Washington to fight for the federal amendment. The National didn't really have its heart in the federal amendment. They were going state by state by state. Alice thought that was taking far too long and was a waste of resources. One amendment for women the country over. When she came back from England in 1910, women could vote in only 5 states, all out west. Very few women voting.
Were they allowed to vote in federal elections or only in state elections?
No, they could vote in federal elections. Okay. So when Alice and her put her tactics behind the federal amendment and her money, she was a great fundraiser. She came into immediate conflict with the leaders of the National, and there was a split, basically. Over her independence, and it took the form of money. They wanted her funds channeled through them. She refused. She went off on her own mission.
Then she started her own organization?
Her own, which eventually became the National Women's Party.
The National Women's Party.
Mm-hmm.
And so her tactics were very different from what had been going on. The strategy was different. What happened when the you talked about the imprisoning of some of the women and the force feeding?
Yes.
How did that come about?
Well, since that parade in 1913, for 4 years, Alice and her followers tried everything. They lobbied, they had more demonstrations. They even went out west and conducted election campaigns using the votes where women could vote in the West to turn out the Democrats, because it was the Democrats, mainly the Southern Democrats, who were blocking the vote. Nothing worked. So by 1917, they felt like something new was needed, some new way to put pressure on Wilson, to put pressure on the Democrats, his fellow Democrats in Congress. And so what they came up with was a picket line in front of the White House. The first people ever to picket the White House.
Hmm. Were we at war at that time?
Not when the picket line went out, which was January of 1917. But by summer, yes, we were at war. And whereas in the beginning they were regarded as curiosities and maybe slightly mad, these women, well-bred, well-dressed women, picketing the White House, by summer they were regarded as treasonous,
yes,
quite possibly traitors. And opposition really built against them, picketing a sitting president in time of war.
And distracting us from our main objective.
Absolutely.
Which is to win the war.
Yeah.
Were there any slogans that they used that conveyed the difference between Wilson, the way he was presenting himself in other countries, and what was happening here?
Well, I could show you a picture
of
that picket line.
Now that's a photo of President Wilson coming out of the White House.
Mm-hmm, in the top hat.
And encountering the pickets on both sides of the gate. And the sign says, Mr. President, what will you do for women's suffrage?
Mm-hmm.
Mr. President, How Long Must Women Wait for Liberty?
Mm-hmm. Remember, Wilson was the great Democrat, make the world safe for democracy. So they were really turning his words against him, you know, and saying 20 million women can't vote. What kind of democracy do we have here in this country?
Yeah, look what you're doing out there and what you're saying out there.
Yeah.
And look what you're doing here. And did that work?
Well, what happened next, by summer, mobs began to gather and attack the women. And their banners, the women called themselves silent sentinels. They just held up these banners. They didn't chant or speak. Their banners were torn from them. They were hurled to the ground. And in an effort to bring order, because you couldn't have a riot on a daily basis in front of the White House, the administration had them arrested. So they were taken to jail and...
Including Alice.
Over the course of the summer, every time they went to jail, short terms, initially, they came right back out and went on the picket line. So by the end of the summer, they had terms of up to 6 months. Alice had 7 months. She was thrown in a psychiatric ward. And there she went on a hunger strike, as before, knowing full well what was involved when authorities decided to force feed you.
Wow. And so how long was she force fed?
Well, she told her followers, she said, here it's worse than in England. Because in England, they only feed you twice a day. Here, they do it three times a day. So three times a day for weeks. She wasn't the only one. Others also went on hunger strikes and underwent force feeding.
And what freed them?
Well, there was by November a lot of pressure building on both the suffragists and the administration. And they had, in November, the women organized one last major picket line. And they were, once again, in prison and very brutally treated, including the force feeding. The administration tried to cover it up, but word leaked out. And so even people who opposed the picketing, probably a majority of people in the country, felt women shouldn't be treated this way.
So it backfired.
It backfired, yeah. And the administration was denounced for treating women in such a brutal fashion. So there was that going on.
So that was the end of 1917?
Toward the end. And that women were released, set free on a technicality. The charge against them, by the way, authorities had a problem with the charge. They had been charged with obstructing traffic.
So now Wilson changed his mind in 1918, is that right?
Yes, almost a year to the date when the pickets went out. Now, there was more to it than just the pickets, because in 1917, New York approved suffrage. That meant suddenly there were 50 members of Congress who were now responsible to women. Women,
yes.
Voters. So pressure was beginning to mount in Congress on Wilson. Your position is untenable. What are we going to do about these women, about giving women the vote? Also, Canada had given women the vote. Britain had given women the vote. The new Russian revolutionary government gave women the vote.
1917. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. He's now being put in a position where he really can't afford to continue to oppose what looks like an inexorable movement.
Right.
Is that right?
Yeah.
And so when was it that he approved and
Well, he changed his mind. He changed his mind in January 1918 and told Congress to support suffrage to the Democrats. It was another year and a half before Congress actually approved the vote, and it was another 14 months before it was ratified, before the amendment was ratified, the 19th Amendment.
I want to ask you some really important questions about what happened afterwards, but Before we do, just because we may not have time, I would like to give the websites of two places where people can learn more about Alice Paul. One of them is the Alice Paul Institute, which is located in her ancestral home in New Jersey, Moorestown, New Jersey. And that is up there on the screen now, the Alice Paul Institute. And the other is in Washington, D.C., the Sewell Belmont House. And in both cases, our viewers can get a lot of information about Alice Paul and about the movement. Just two more things that I think are particularly interesting. One is the once Congress passed the amendment, it had to go to the states for ratification, and it required 3/4 of the votes of the states. What was the last state that came in? Which one was that?
That was Tennessee in August of 1920.
So it was about 14 months from the time the Congress had passed it until the last state that they needed. And was there anything interesting about Tennessee that was it dramatic?
There's a wonderful little story about Tennessee. The legislature was tied. And there, I mean, it had been a fierce struggle. And so it came up for a vote, and the anti-suffragists were sure they had won because it was tied, sure it wouldn't pass. And the youngest member of the legislature, Harry Byrne, it came to him, and he astonished everybody by voting for the amendment.
Passed by one vote.
And later he was asked, well, later a second man joined him. So, but later he was asked why he had changed his mind, because he had changed his mind. And he said, well, he said, I had a note from my mother. Oh. And my mother said, do the right thing and vote for suffrage. And he said, you know, a young man should always listen to what his mother said. True story.
True. So that every time we think that one person can't make a difference,
yes.
One person made a difference. We're almost out of time. Is there one or two things you can tell us about why you feel Alice Paul is not well known?
She's not well known for I believe, for the same reason many prominent women are not well known. The histories are written by men. The biographies of Wilson, and I read them, I read them all, barely mention suffrage, scarcely mention Alice Paul by name. This was front page news. There are pages and pages about Wilson's anti-tariff policy. Nothing to speak of about suffrage. An amendment to the Constitution that passed during his administration. One big blank in history.
That is fascinating. Well, we're out of time. The whole story was fascinating.
Oh.
And that I didn't know that about the Wilson biographies. That's quite a discovery that you made.